Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction. To be honest, we didn't exactly flip a coin. I said, obviously, Rajat is a former managing director of McKinsey, which I was the most junior of junior partners, had the right to capture your attention before I came on board. Also should commend Rajat on his announcement about becoming a grandfather for the first time. That's really wonderful news. Unfortunately, my only family announcement is I survived having my 18-year-old home for Thanksgiving. So I don't know. Your daughter will soon find out what it's like, Rajat. You well know. Anyway, our theme today is challenges to business and society in the 21st century, the way forward. And obviously, in order to determine the way forward, we must find out where we stand today. And like Rajat, I would say that the relationship today between businesses and individuals, as consumers, as borrowers, as investors, as employees, it's obviously quite strained. At this moment in America, in the wake of the global economic crisis, as Rajat indicated, I would echo, the public holds a generally cynical view towards business in general and Wall Street in particular. We're contemplating regulatory reform because our existing oversight system has not evolved with the rapidly evolving financial services industry. We're rethinking healthcare. In Congress and across the nation, people are grappling with what could be the most significant overhaul of the healthcare system in more than 40 years. These are clearly fundamental issues that have the potential for changing our society in bold and unforeseeable ways. As David Brooks wrote recently in the New York Times, and I quote, "We're having a debate about what kind of country we want America to be." What role will business play as society tries to right itself is a key question that is before us this evening. How can we as Americans achieve a more balanced state to ensure long-term financial security for our society is an issue that is on the minds of many of our fellow citizens. And that's what I would like to talk about with you this evening. And I'm going to focus on three things. One is our opportunity to revisit the social contract, in particular, the goal that all of us serve or share of getting to and through a retirement safely. Secondly, we must spend a moment thinking about measures that we can implement to help businesses adopt a more prudent, long-term view, similar to some of the themes that Rajat discussed. And thirdly, I'd like to talk about steps that we can take to help individuals enjoy sound financial health over the long run. So first, let me start with what I describe as the social contract. Over the past few decades, employees have assumed greater responsibility for their careers, professional development, advancement, and retirement. The workforce has become much more mobile as it has been forced to adapt to the global economy. And we are now in an age of employment at will. And in that age of employment at will, we find that the bonds that bring us together as employers and employees are much weakened. Corporate loyalty has waned. We know that lifetime employment is not an option anymore, but as we rethink and renew the social contract, it's clear that lifetime income should be one of our objectives. This evening, because of me and Rajat, you'll hear some McKinsey research. In my case, I want to talk about research on retirement, and there's new research from McKinsey and Company that finds that the average American family will face a savings gap of $250,000 at the time of retirement. Even with pensions from Social Security and private pensions, as well as personal savings and 401ks and other retirement plans, the average American family will have only about two-thirds of the income that it will need in order to retire safely and securely. Moreover, again, according to some McKinsey research, for every 5 years we wait to address the issue of retirement security, we'll see a 10% decline in the typical retiree's standard of living. Now, that's one reason why I want to address with you the question of how can we respond to this very weakened social contract that exists, particularly around getting individuals safely to and through retirement. And my answer to that is that we need a holistic system that assures that Americans will have the retirement income that they'll need. And that system would have four or five major elements. First, it would ensure full participation and sufficient funding by enrolling employees automatically on their first day of work and offering incentives for employers and employees to encourage them to contribute a total of 10 to 14% of pay. That's about double today's contributions. That number, 10 to 14%, did not come about by accident. Rather, it is the result of a great deal of actuarial analysis that shows that each American during his or her working life, along with contributions from their employer, needs to save approximately 10 to 14% of pay in order to replace around 70% of their working income when they retire. And that is what most people think is necessary for a safe and secure retirement. Now, we've already taken some steps in this direction. Automatic enrollment in IRAs, which President Obama has proposed, could provide a tax-favored saving opportunity to those without a workplace retirement plan. And currently, believe it or not, about half of Americans do not have a workplace retirement plan. The second element of a holistic system would be to help employees manage the risks by offering a menu of 15 to 20 investment options to provide sufficient diversification without presenting an overwhelming number of choices. And again, that number 15 to 20 is not chosen by accident. Rather, a great deal of research by behavioral economists shows that with more than 20 options, stymied and frozen into inaction, with fewer than 10 or so, there probably is not sufficient diversification. The third thing that we need for a holistic retirement system is a system that would give workers financial education and, importantly, objective, non-commissioned advice to help them to build the portfolios that they need to reflect their own personal goals and their own risk tolerance. And this issue of financial literacy and financial education is a theme that I will return to later. Fourth, the kind of system that I envision would provide opportunities and incentives to save for retirement medical expenses. And even as our society goes through a grand debate about health care, one fact has not been mentioned, which is that today the average couple of 65 needs to have, believe it or not, between $200,000 and $800,000 set aside just for health care expenses in their retirement period. And given the fact that 401ks are approximately $50,000 to $60,000 right now, even after the recent market rally, it is going to be out of the reach for many, many Americans to provide for sufficient savings to deal with their health care expenses in retirement. So this is truly a national crisis. And finally, a holistic system that deals with the social contract that I think we must have with our workers would provide lifetime income through a fair, appropriately priced, affordable fixed annuity option. I start with this because I believe that we have an obligation to help our colleagues, our neighbors, and our fellow citizens get safely to and through retirement. With this holistic system that I've outlined, we can help all Americans enjoy greater financial security. And one of the great challenges of this crisis is that it has shown how truly insecure the vast majority of Americans really are. But in order to achieve that goal, we need to encourage businesses and individuals to adopt a more balanced, long-term risk management approach. And that is the second thing that I'd like to turn to, promoting financial security in business itself. As we look to the recovery from the worst recession we've had in 70 years, we must be mindful of the far-reaching structural changes that have altered the macro economy here in the U.S. and globally. Those changes include a globalization of capital, labor, and production, and the evolving role of national governments in driving growth and in expanding regulatory oversight. These forces may have a moderating effect on inflation, particularly given the current phenomenon of rising unemployment and the strongest productivity growth rate that we've seen over any six-month period in the last 40 years. But these same forces that have led to what economists describe as the Great Moderation also have created and continue to create conditions that are favorable for asset bubbles, sudden and sharp price increases in discrete sectors of the market. Commercial real estate showed such a bubble in the late 1980s, the dot-com equity market of the late 1990s, and obviously the housing market of the current decade are all examples of the tendency to create bubbles in the modern society. In such an environment, businesses must resist the temptation of short-termism and focus instead on sustainability. A group of financial and academic leaders convened by the Aspen Institute recently have posited, quote, that a healthy society requires healthy and responsible companies that effectively pursue long-term goals, end quote. Citing the insidious nature of the problem, the group noted, and again I quote, many college savings, 401ks, and related retirement funds engage in behavior that is inconsistent with their investors' goals as they trade securities, pay their managers, and engage in or support activism in pursuit of short-term financial objectives, all at the expense of the long-term performance and careful analysis of fundamental risk. Regulatory reform, I believe, can help in this regard. Indeed, as Rajat has already indicated, a financial regulatory reform package is currently making its way through Congress. I do share some of his concerns about that package. I would say, however, that well-conceived reforms can ensure that financial services firms are able to innovate, to develop new businesses, and to take reasonable risks with an appropriate supervisory framework that promotes overall long-term stability and also protects market participants. In fact, I was here at the NYU Stern School in September for a panel discussion on regulatory reform with Eric Donalo, who used to be the Commissioner of Insurance here in New York. And one of the items that we discussed at that point was the creation of an optional federal charter for insurance industries. And this measure, which TIAA-CREF supports, would provide life insurers with the choice to be regulated by a single federal entity or to continue to operate under the current state-by-state regulatory structure. An optional federal charter could increase the efficiency of the life insurance industry, maintain product safety, and also soundness, and make the U.S. life insurers more competitive on a global scale. I raise this because it is one example of numerous ideas that are now being discussed or should be discussed as the country rethinks the regulatory structure for financial services and does so for the first time since the Great Depression. Now, we all know that proper reform will take time, but there are steps that businesses themselves can take today to operate more prudently, such as strengthening their risk management programs and ensuring through good corporate governance that their strategies and compensation are aligned with the long-term interests of shareholders. This can drive corporate performance and also help to strengthen the market overall. Further, shareholders in the United States should be given greater rights, at least in my judgment, including access to the proxy to nominate directors, majority voting in director elections, and a shareholder vote on at least the structure of executive compensation. Shareholders and companies have a common goal of long-term wealth creation, and therefore, I believe they must work together toward that goal. By encouraging businesses to adopt a more rational long-term approach, we can enhance our financial security, and individuals also must be forced with or given an opportunity to enhance their financial security. So let me now turn to my third theme, which is helping individuals achieve financial security. Since the mid-1980s, the ratio of household debt to disposable income more than doubled, increasing from around 65% to an unsustainable all-time high of 133% in 2007. Americans have been living beyond their means. Two-thirds of U.S. GDP was driven by consumer spending, and easy credit helped to fuel our growth. That's clearly changing now, quite dramatically, out of necessity. The personal savings rate, which was around 10% of income in the 1970s, fell to zero in 2005, is now back to about 5%. Households are clearly focused on paying down their debts. This deleveraging will have a dampening effect on consumer spending in the short term, but I believe it bodes well for the long-term economic stability of the United States and globally. Encouraging individuals to save more will certainly help restore their personal balance sheets to good health. One way to do that is with financial education. In a recent study, Americans over the age of 50 were asked three questions involving interest rates, the effects of inflation, and the concept of risk diversification. I'll share the questions with you You may judge the difficulty for yourself. I will not ask you to raise hands to give me your answers. Perhaps I should. This is a law school, after all. So here's the first question. Suppose you had $100 in a savings account and the interest rate was 2% per year. After 5 years, how much do you think you would have in the account if you left your money to grow? You had three choices: more than $102, exactly $102, or less than $102. When you find out how this came out, you will perhaps not find it so funny. Second, imagine that the interest rate on your savings account was 1% per year and inflation was 2% per year. After 1 year, would you be able to buy more than exactly the same as or less than today with the money in this account? Question about inflation, obviously. And the third question, do you think that the following statement is true or false? And here's the statement. Quote, buying a single company stock usually provides a safer return than a stock mutual fund. Again, I won't ask you to answer these questions, but I will tell you the sad truth, that only half of the respondents, over 50 Americans, were able to correctly answer the first two questions, and only one-third of the respondents were able to correctly answer all three questions. And these are Americans over the age of 50, individuals who are either close to retirement or in retirement. So you may wonder, then, if the ability to solve a few basic math problems creates such a challenge, what does that mean with respect to financial security? And obviously, the two things are closely intertwined. Individuals with a lower degree of financial literacy have a number of traits that won't surprise you. They tend to borrow more, they accumulate less wealth, and they select mutual funds with higher fees. They're less likely to invest in stocks, more likely to experience difficulty with debt, less likely to know the terms of their mortgages and other loans. And many would argue that one of the reasons that we are confronting the crisis that we have today, not the only reason, but one of the reasons, was an absence of financial literacy in America at large. The lesson that your mothers undoubtedly taught you and my mother taught me, if it is too good to be true, it is probably too good to be true, is a lesson that obviously many Americans did not learn. So it is clear that if we're going to strengthen the long-term financial security of our society, we must do more to improve financial literacy. And importantly, financial services firms such as my own can and should lead the way. In considering the steps that our nation can take to promote long-term financial literacy, we need to strengthen the relationship between business and individuals. We must more closely align the interests of employers and employees, sellers and consumers, issuers and investors. We clearly need to wean ourselves off the unchecked consumerism and focus on exporting and investing to drive growth. We need to save more and consume less. And we need to think about what kind of country we want America to be. Now, I've spoken today about the importance of creating a new social contract, which includes a holistic system to help Americans enjoy a more secure retirement. It includes eschewing short-termism in favor of long-term performance, sustainable value creation, and prudent risk management in our largest and medium-sized American companies, and includes advocating a balanced approach to saving and investing by raising the level of financial literacy. By seizing these opportunities, we will strengthen our economy, we'll create a more vibrant and financially sound society, and indeed, we will confront the 21st century successfully. Thank you all very much for your attention.